emotions, not how I wanna live, how I wanna live. You are my devotion, it's my heart I wanna give, heart I wanna give. I just wanna praise you. My heart I wanna give, heart I wanna give. How can I stand still, knowing all you've done for me? How can I not bring an offering of praise?
Well, we're going to continue on in our study of 1 Peter, and we had taken a couple weeks off. 2 weeks ago, we did a Mother's Day sermon where we looked at Rezabah and her response to her kids being hung. Last week, we had Pastor Justin from Kensington. He shared a little bit about the life of David, so we had a good little hiatus. But now we're going to jump back in to 1 Peter. We're going to pick it up in 1 Peter chapter 3, and I want to make sure that we give a little bit of background before we get into that, because this is one of those difficult passages that every preacher comes to and says, hey, we need to handle this very, very carefully and very diligently. Now, if you remember in 1 Peter chapter 2, we saw that Peter was telling us that we need to submit to every human institution, and we needed to do that for a number of different reasons. And so that begins around chapter 2, verse 12, verse 13, starts this whole section. And so that section continues on until we get to chapter 3, verse 1 and following. So what I want to do here is I want to jump right in here to 1 Peter chapter 3, starting in verse 1, and kind of go through this. Okay, it says this right here. It says, in the same way, you wives, be submissive to your own husbands. Now, I want to stop right there. I don't even want to go through the rest of the verse because now you know what this verse has to say. And of course, anybody who understands our culture and understands what's going on in our world has to be very delicate when they come to this passage of scripture because we want to make sure that we interpret it correctly. And so he says here, we need to look at that phrase, in the same way. And so what is he talking about, in the same way? I think one of the problems that a lot of a lot of interpreters, they go back to the antecedent. That is, where have they seen this before? And they don't go back far enough. Normally, they will go back to chapter 2, verse 18. And chapter 2, verse 18 says this, servants, be submissive to your masters with all respect. Now, if that's what we go back to, if that's as far as we go back to, I can understand wives and women being upset about this because it's kind of like, what are you talking about? Is Peter saying that in the same way that a servant would be submissive to their master, that's the same way that a wife is supposed to be submissive to her husband? And we've had men in the past, those who are call themselves Bible teachers, would say, yes, that's exactly what he's saying. But that is not what he's saying. Now, I got to be careful here because I am known as a Bible teacher. I am known as somebody who tries to interpret scripture correctly. And Peter does say right here, in the same way. But what we need to do is go to the antecedent before the antecedent that starts this whole section to understand the context and what he's talking about and what does he mean in the same way. So let's go back to 1 Peter chapter 2. Verse 13, actually I'm going to start in verse 12, and let's look at that, okay? Let's read through that. Let's remind ourselves what the Word of God has to say there. All right, chapter 2, verse 12 says this. Peter says, keep your behavior excellent among the Gentiles, so that in the thing in which they slander you as evildoers, they may, on account of your good deeds, as they observe them, glorify God in the day of visitation. Remember that? Now, verse 13, and this is where we find the first time with dealing with submit. This starts this whole section. In verse 13, he says, submit yourselves for the Lord's sake to every human institution, whether to a king as one in authority, or to governors as sent by him for the punishment of evildoers and the praise of those who do right. For such is the will of God, that by doing right you may silence the ignorance of foolish men. So if we look at that passage of scripture right there, before we even get to chapter 3, verse 1, if we look at this, what is Peter saying? Peter's saying there is five reasons that we should submit to human institutions. Now we're going to go over those five reasons. Number one, for the Lord's sake. Number two, to win unbelievers to Jesus Christ. Number three, that God might get the glory. Number four, it is God's will. And number five, that we may silence the ignorance of foolish men. Now let me go through those five one more time because we need to keep those five in context because those five overlay this entire section. When Peter says in the same way, he is going back to chapter 2, verse 13. Yes, it does include part of 18 as well, but we're going to see how that breaks out. But here are the five reasons again. For the Lord's sake, we need to submit. We need to submit to win unbelievers to Jesus Christ. Number three, so that God might get the glory. Number four, because it is God's will. And number five, so that we might silence the ignorance of foolish men. That is why we need to submit in this whole submission section. So what he's saying to wives is that the reason, the overlying reason that you should submit to your husbands is for the same five reasons. The world is looking at you, looking at marriage. They have no picture of what a godly marriage should be. And a godly marriage reflects God's goodness to this world. Now we're going to continue on here and go back to verse 1 again. He says, in the same way, you wives be submissive to your own husbands. Now, what does he mean, you be submissive to your own husbands? Now, let's go back to chapter 2, verse 18, the first antecedent, okay? Let's go back there. What does he say? He says that servants are to be submissive to their masters. In other words, there is a way in which servants should be submissive to their masters. Now, chapter 3, verse 1, he says, wives should be submissive to their husbands in the same way. But he is not saying the same way that a servant is submissive to their master, a wife should be submissive to her husband. What he's saying is that in the same way, the same reasons that we see in chapter 2, verse 12 and 13, that you should be submissive because of these reasons. In other words, you should be submissive to a husband the way that a wife should be submissive to a husband. A servant should be submissive to their master, the way that a servant should be submissive to their master. In other words, yes, be submissive in the same way, but not doing the exact same thing, if that makes any sense. And then if we stay with the text, we'll see, because Peter's going to explain what it means for a wife to be submissive to her husband. All right, so let's continue on here. Verse 1 again. In the same way, you wives, be submissive to your own husbands. Your own husbands. I want to focus there on that pronoun own. Your own husband. Peter is not saying that women should be submissive to men. That is nowhere in the text. There is nowhere in Scripture. Yes, those who are employees should be submissive to their employers. Yes, citizens should be submissive to their government. All those type of things. That is this whole overview. But he does not say that women are to be submissive to men. What Peter is saying is that wives, you need to be submissive to your husband, not somebody else's husband, not some husband to be. You need to be submissive to your own husband. It shows possession there. And what Peter is saying basically is this, that you chose this man to be your husband. That means that you chose, out of all the men on the face of the earth, you decided that this is the man that you want to be submissive to. Now, once again, you say, well, you know, maybe he don't deserve to be for me to be submissive to him. Well, wait a minute. Let's go back to the five things again. The reason that you are to be submissive to your husband, why? For the Lord's sake. Number 2, so that unbelievers may come to Jesus Christ. Number 3, that God may get the glory out of your marriage. Number 4, because it is God's will. And number 5, that you might silence the ignorance of foolish men. And your husband might be one of them foolish men, but we'll get to that in a minute. But I just want to say, there's still the same 5 reasons to be submissive to your husband. Now, you chose him. That personal pronoun, your own husband. Now you can say, yeah, he pursued me. He chased me down. Yeah, he chased you down, but you still had to say yes. You still had to be the one that say, okay, I'm going to go along with the program. As my wife always say, you take 2 to tango. And so you accepted the challenge and you have own this individual, and so you need to be submissive to him. Now you say, wait, I don't need some man. I don't need him. You know what? I'm going to agree with you. I am going to agree with you. Wives, you don't need your husband. You don't need him. I'm saying that for the record. Wives, you don't need your husband. It's a new day, new day. You don't need your husband, okay? And I'm going to tell you that the man, the husband, needs you. You know why I'm going to say that? I'm going to go back to Genesis. Go back to Genesis. God created the heavens and the earth. And, you know, on 5 days, he created everything. Everything was good. And created animals. Everything was good. And then he created Adam. And at the end of the day, he said, this is not good that he's alone. He needs a helpmate. The man needed help. He needed help. It don't say Eve needed help. And when God put him to sleep and took out his rib and created a woman and brought the woman to the man, it still don't say that Eve needed that man. It is Adam who needed her. Matter of fact, you can see that anecdotally, right? I see these older couples, and you know, they live a nice long life for the most part, and then what happens when the husband dies? The husband dies and the wife keeps on ticking. Matter of fact, she live another 10, 15, 20 years, and she misses old boy, but old boy is gone. Now, what happens if it's the other way around? What if she passes first? You know, if the wife passes first, generally what happens is that man is gone the same year, maybe a year later, 2 years. It's something about once his honey gone, he got no more reason for living. So that is not the issue. The issue is not whether you need a man or not. The issue boils down to these five things. I'm going to go over it again. That you are being submissive for the Lord's sake. Number two, that when unbelievers to Jesus Christ. Number three, that God might get the glory out of your marriage. Number three, because it is God's will. And number four, that you may silence the ignorance of foolish men and women who are trying to tear down your marriage, but God's the one who has designed it, and he knows that it will give him glory. You know, I know you say, well, you know, it's hard to submit to some man. I don't know if I can do it. Let me tell you something. I ain't done enough of these premarital counseling that I know that you can submit to a man. I know that. You know how I know that? Because in premarital counseling, you finishing the man's sentence. You know what I mean? You finishing his sentence. He can't even get his sentence out, and you finish it for him. And you know, and you laugh at his jokes. I'm sitting up in premarital counseling. I'm just like, that joke ain't funny. But you just laugh, and oh, it's so hilarious. Everything he say is hilarious. And you want to know, you know, honey, what do you want? What do you want? What do you want? You know, it's all, what does he want? You know, you like musical chairs, right? You just running around. Y'all played musical chairs before. You walking around the chairs, whatever, as long as the music is playing. That's how y'all are. That's how wives are. And you know, they go around them. And then you get married and the music stops. Y'all know what happened when the music stopped. All of a sudden, all of that Google Gaga is out the window. Look here. Jesus is saying, Peter is saying, God is saying in this text, that the reason for being submissive to your husband got nothing to do with you. It is something bigger than you, something greater than you, something that God is doing. And so he desires that you might be submissive to your husband. Let's continue on here. Once again, verse 1 again. In the same way, not same way, we looked at that. You wives be submissive to your own husband. We went through that. He says, so that if any of them are disobedient to the word. Now, I'm going to look at that right now. Disobedient to the word. Now, that might be part of silencing the ignorance of foolish men. Maybe you married to a fool. Maybe you married to somebody who is rebellious against God, doesn't want to hear anything about it. He's saying that even in that situation, your being submissive will shut his mouth. Well, let's continue on. He says, so that even if any of them are disobedient to the word, they may be won without a word by the behavior of their wives, as they observe your chaste or holy and respectful behavior. So he says two things here, two things for wives to understand. There are two aspects of being submissive to your husband. And this makes it different from what we see in chapter 2, verse 18, servants being submissive to their masters. It's a different type of submission. It is for the same reason, the same principle. God has this order of authority and submission, but how a wife submits to her husband is different than the way in which a servant would be submissive to their master. So what do we see here? We see two things. There's a negative aspect of it, and then there's a positive aspect of it. A negative aspect of it and a positive aspect of it. Let's look at the negative aspect first. He says that they may be won without a word by the behavior of their wives. In other words, he's saying stop the arguing and the complaining with the brother. Stop it. All right? Let your behavior speak for itself. You know, I know, you know, it's kind of like, well, I got my own mind, I got my own opinion, I understand that, but there is a way in which you communicate to your husband what your needs and desires are, but arguing, going toe-to-toe with him ain't gonna work. Matter of fact, turn with me right quick. We're just gonna turn there right quick and come back. Proverbs 21:9. I don't know if you've seen this verse before. Proverbs 21:9, what does it say? Proverbs 21:9 says this: it is better to live on a corner of the roof than to share a house with a quarrelsome wife. You hear that? Let me read that again. Better to live on a corner of a roof than to share a house with a quarrelsome wife. Let me tell you something. Arguing with your man is not going to help at all. That brother would rather be on the roof of your house. Could you imagine coming home one day? Could you imagine coming home one day and you see your husband up on the roof in the corner near the chimney? And you say, honey, what you doing up there? And he's like, I ain't coming down. I'm staying up here because I am tired of arguing and fighting with you. So Peter says, hey, don't win him by arguing. Do it with your behavior. Now, what's the positive aspect? The positive aspect is this, that they observe your behavior, right? As, and what does your behavior look like? It says, as they observe your chaste, which is holy and respectful behavior. In other words, respect your husband. Most men don't care if you love them or not. They want respect. And I'm telling you, it's the wise woman who strokes the ego of her husband that can get him to do almost anything that you want him to do. And Peter's saying this is what the secret is to submission. Think about that. It is the key to getting what you want, or to helping your husband to see things by stroking his ego. He's saying, well, you know, I'm not down with that. I'm gonna stroke no man's ego. Well, you know, wait a minute. How do you respond when you go to work and your boss is a man? You know, he asks you to do something, go take care of something, whatever. You say, well, that's different because I get paid. Well, maybe it is, maybe not. But your husband knows that you jump when the boss says jump. You want to know how high you should jump? When he says you need to come in, he sees you go in. He sees you respond to this boss, but know that you don't respond to him the same way you do another man. I want to tell you something else, too. I just want to be clear here, too. Look here. Don't submit to your pastor more than you do to your husband. I'm going to say this right here. I get nothing out of it. I know there's some pastors just love the fact that they feel like they got some kind of control over the women in their church. Look here, I'm not one of them, but I'm going to tell you one thing. You need to respect your husband way more than you respect your pastor. You know, I want respect now, but you know, praise the Lord, you come to Tree of Life and you're under my leadership. Sure, I want you to respect me, but I want you to respect your husband more. You know, that's why so many men don't come to church. They don't come to church because they say, hey, you know, you go up there and listen to that man, everything he got to say, anything he asks from you, you do it. But yet I ask you to do some things, you want to argue with me. No, 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 no. You have your own husband. There is a man that you have chosen to submit to. And Peter is saying that you are to submit to your own husband. Let me tell you, what does that look like? What does this look like? Well, I just think that when you think about submitting to your husband, just think about what you would do at work. What would you do if your pastor asked you to do something? What would you do if your father asked you to do something? And take that and say, this is what I will do for my husband. Well, he goes on here in verse 3, and I want to continue on here because I think I've kind of dealt with the submission part. But he goes on and he talks about in verse 3, and let not your adornment, your clothing, be merely external. That is the braiding of hair and the wearing of gold jewelry or putting on of dresses. But let it be the hidden person of the heart with the imperishable quality of a gentle and quiet spirit, which is precious in the sight of God. Peter says, you know, I want to make emphasis here. He said, don't let your adornment merely be the external. Now, I want to say right now, as a husband, you know, external is important. You know what I mean? I'm speaking for all the brothers here. Brothers, any brothers in the house want to ditto that? Yeah, we want you to look good. But what Peter is saying is that the same amount of work you do on the external, make sure you do the same amount or even more on the internal person. And see here, he says right here, the quiet and gentle spirit. What it means is not argumentative. It doesn't mean if you're a talkative person, you shouldn't talk. What it means is the manner in which you respond is gentle and kind. He said, that's what it is. When you do speak, make sure that your talk is seasoned with love and with grace. And that will respect your husband. Now, I know we all different personalities. You know, some people, whether it's male or female, some people are loud, some people are extroverted, some people are quiet, some are introverted, some are thinkers, some think when they talk. Everybody is different. And I think about this sometimes, you know, I'm a people watcher, so I watch people, and I know this. I know that there are different levels of attractiveness. Sometimes a person has beautiful eyes, and sometimes some other people have beautiful hair, and some people have a beautiful complexion, and every now and then you'll find a person who has all of these qualities, and we say that person is beautiful or handsome. And you know, just like the external, I think it's the same way for the internal. Some people are just born and they are just more beautiful internally than others, and others have to work at it. But one thing I do know is this, is that if almost anybody can make themselves look attractive on the external, they might have to work a little bit harder, they might have to do some certain things, but everybody can make themselves more attractive externally. And what Peter is saying is that do the same effort internally that you would do externally, and this is pleasing to God. And then finally here, he closes out, because I'm going to end it here, and then I'm going to deal with the men next week. I know the wives are saying, so when you going to get to the brothers? Look here, all next week is the brothers, okay? All next week, I'm going to be on the brothers. So don't worry about it. Their turn is coming. But we're going to finish this out here in verse 5. He says, for in this way, this is what Peter says, in this way, or you can say in the same way, in former times the holy women, see there, it's kind of the chaste thing that we saw earlier, the holy women also who hoped in God used to adorn themselves, being submissive to their own husbands. You see that there, their own husbands. The Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord, and you have become her children if you do what is right without being frightened by any fear. Now, I know there's a lot of confusion about this, and I heard wives say, wait a minute, I'm not calling my husband Lord. Is that what Peter's saying? Well, this is just something I'm going to be disobedient with. Well, you don't have to be disobedient, because that's not what Peter is really saying. Peter is giving you an example of Sarah. And we got to understand here, right? There are 4,000 years removed from us and Sarah. And sometimes when we look at this, we think, well, maybe Peter was a contemporary of Abraham and Sarah. Look here, between us and Peter is 2,000 years. Between Peter and Sarah is 2,000 years, right? So Peter is looking back. He's looking back on time. And he's saying things used to happen back then that are even different from his day. But he's saying, let's look at Sarah and see how Sarah responded as an example of being submissive. So let's go to chapter 18 of Genesis. Genesis chapter 18. And this is what we're going to end with. Genesis chapter 18, because we want to go back to the exact passage that Peter is talking about. Now, what's happening here in Genesis 18, you remember God came to visit Abraham, and he's got his two angels with him. And so they're in the form of men, and they come to Abraham, and he prepares a dinner for him. He tells Sarah to, you know, get things prepared. And so now the Lord is having a conversation with Abraham about what's going to happen in a year from that time. So we pick it up right there in verse 9. It says, then they said to him, that is, they said to Abraham, where is Sarah your wife? And he said, that is, Abraham said, behold, in the tent. And he said, this is the Lord speaking, and he said, I will surely return to you this time next year, and behold, Sarah, your wife, shall have a son. And Sarah was listening at the tent door, which was behind him. And now Abraham and Sarah were all advanced in age. Sarah was past childbearing. I want to stop right there. Past childbearing. Let me tell you something. Sarah was several decades past childbearing. So Abraham is about 99 years old. Sarah is about 89 years old. In other words, they both are old. Now, verse 12. It says, and Sarah laughed to herself, saying, after I become old, shall I have pleasure? My Lord being old also. There you are right there. My Lord being old also. Sarah called Abraham Lord, but you know what? Abraham did not hear her say that. Sarah was saying that to herself, and she was laughing at the situation. Abraham is too old to be able to be parenting kids. He got no more swimmers in the sack, if you know what I mean. And she's got no more eggs in the sack. How in the world is this going to happen? And so she's laughing at the thought of this. And yet, even in her humor, she respects her husband. That's what Peter is saying. Peter is saying that you have an example in Sarah who respects her husband greatly, even though he did not even hear what Sarah had to say. Well, let's continue the passage here in verse 13. It says, and the Lord said to Abraham, because the Lord heard it, and the Lord said to Abraham, why did Sarah laugh, saying, shall I indeed bear a child when I am so old? Is anything too difficult for the Lord? At the appointed time, I will return to you at this time next year, and Sarah shall have a son. Now look what Sarah did. It says, Sarah denied it, however, saying, I did not laugh. And why did she say that? It says, for she was afraid. And he said, but no, you did laugh. Sarah was afraid. What does Peter say? Peter says, be like Sarah in the respecting of her husband, even calling him Lord, even though he could not hear it. That was the desire or the direction of her heart. Be like her, but don't be fearful. Trust in the Lord, trust in the Lord's word instead of doubting what the Lord says. That is what Peter's saying. Peter's saying, trust the Lord in this, live by faith, and don't be fearful like you saw in Sarah. Of course, I'm definitely not the best preacher in the world. I'm sure some of y'all can testify to that. But one of the things I do is I do teach preaching at the seminary. Sometimes you can be a better coach than you are a player. And so I'm able to observe my students and to help them to be better communicators. And a lot of times they are better communicators than I am. But one of the things I have some of my students do, and it just depends upon who they are, is I will tell them, okay, you know what? I don't want you to preach this passage. At least I don't want you to preach this passage with your mouth. I want you to preach this passage without saying a word. And so they have to go through the motions of getting water out of the well. They have to go through the motions of demonstrating the rain is coming down upon them. They have to show the emotions of the first time that Adam saw Eve. They have to preach the passage without saying a word. God is saying to wives, you want to be submissive to your husband? Demonstrate your love and respect to him without even saying a word. And that may change the heart and silence the foolish individual that you might happen to be married to. Father God, we thank you for your word. Although this is a tough passage, sometimes I think it is just not understood. Submission is viewed as a dirty word. And when taken out of context, one would not understand what you are trying to communicate. But we know Peter is just saying that a wife's life speaks louder than words, and respect for their husband has a bigger impact than anything that they could ever say. I pray for the wives today that you would help them to understand what that means in their own life. And Lord, I know next week we will deal with the husbands. And I pray that even before then, you would give me wisdom to communicate to husbands how they are to love their wives. May you get the glory. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Into the void you spoke. for light to awaken color, foundation of grace to behold your face, to gaze at the beauty one. You made a way for us as lightning makes way for thunder. You died to save my sin erased. Oh, what amazing love. Watched over all the galaxies, stepped out into humanity. Not just a man, and still is to come. You're everywhere right here, first and the last, Lion the Lamb, the greatest of all time. History obeys your word, dominion in all the kingdom, perfectly God, perfectly man. Salvation is in your hands. Watched over all the galaxies, stepped out into humanity. Yours is the King. Cause yours is the King. Not just a man, God in flesh and bones, the only man who died to save the lost just like me. Not just a man, the great I am.